Our call to worship comes from the psalmist, Psalm 19, reading the first four verses and then 7 to 10. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voices go out into all the earth. Their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens God has pitched a tent for the sun. The law is perfect, refreshing the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from a honeycomb. Let us respond to that call to worship by praising the Lord and proclaiming that Jesus is mine. Let us join together and sing from our hearts.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, perfect delight, visions of rapture now burst on my sight. Angels descending, ring from above, echoes of mercy, whispers of love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Praising my Savior all the day long.
Good morning, all you wonderful people. I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I wish to welcome you to our service as we've gathered to praise and worship the Lord and just become silent at the foot of the cross. A great big welcome to you wherever you may be. I truly hope and trust and pray that the Lord will touch you during our service and that our service will have meaning to you today. Before we commence, may I inquire on how you are doing? Are you still okay? Are you still coping? How is the health? And have you come through the COVID unscathed? And those of you who did have it or feel a little bit anxious about it, are you still coping? Please remember that God is always there to reach out to you, and you just reach out to him and hold on to him very tightly so that he can take you through this time. Just before we get started with our service today, just a reminder, and I'm so excited about this, that our church at Rand Park Ridge opens on the 11th of October. Just to remind you once again that we are going to have only one service, and that will be at 9 o'clock. So please, I'm so looking forward to welcoming you back into the church. Please take note that when you come to church on the 11th, that you all have to be wearing masks. The stewards at the door will be having hand sanitizer and they will be screening you. They will have a thermometer in measuring your temperature. But all the necessary precautions will be in place, and we need to follow the protocols as set out by the COVID-19 committee. So please, there's no need to worry about the COVID. We will be safe and we will follow all the necessary safety precautions. Come, let us get our vocal cords loose. Come, let us sing something that's lively. Let us proclaim and let us tell God that we are going to be praising Him today. Let's join together in singing that very fast song, Your People Sing Praises. Come, let us all approach the throne of God. Come, let us come before Him in prayer. Let us pray. O most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we greet You this morning, Lord, as we've gathered together as Your people to praise You, Your people to worship You, and just bow our heads and bend our knees to proclaim Your majesty. Because You are our God, and You, dear Lord Jesus, You are our King, and it is You that we praise and worship this morning. O Holy Spirit, You that resides within us, You are the Trinity that we worship, and we submit to Your authority. We praise You, and we worship You. But Lord, we know that as we gather as Your people about You, we also have to confess our sins because, Lord, You said You love the sinner, but You hate the sin. And therefore, You do not want to be in the same place as sin. And therefore, Lord, we want to ask Your forgiveness this morning. O Lord, we are a people that are so fragile. And we know that we sin without even thinking about it, Lord. And therefore, we need to come to You and empty our hearts before You. So, Lord, in our silence now, we just offer You our personal and individual confessions. Hear them now in our silence, Lord. O gracious Lord, we have emptied our hearts before you, Lord, and we pray, Lord, that you will forgive us our sins, Lord, each and every one of them, so that truly, Lord, you've made this wonderful promise to us that if we do repent and turn from our wicked ways, you will forgive us, so that we can be reconciled to you, that we can be with the Almighty God, the God of gods and the Lord of lords. O Lord, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity that we have to atone for our sins, Lord, that we can come to you this morning, this today, Lord, whenever we may be watching this video, Lord, that we can come to you and ask for forgiveness. But Lord, as we come this morning, you assured us of our forgiveness. Help us to go into a world not feeling guilty of anything, but knowing that we are forgiven for all those sins. Yes, Lord, we are not perfect and we are not better than others, but our sins have been forgiven. And help us to understand this, help us to realize this as we go into that world. Oh Lord, as we gather this morning as your people about you, we just pray your touch upon our repentant hearts. We pray, Lord, that you will embrace us with your love, that you will embrace us and bring a peace and a calm upon us, and that you will just be with us, Lord. Bless our service as we've come to praise and worship you this morning. And we pray this in the name above all names, the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Come, let us grab our Bibles. Let us read. Let us read the Word of God. Let us hear what He has to say to us today. Our reading today comes from Exodus chapter 20, reading verses 1 to 4, 7 to 9, and 12 to 20. I'm sure you know this passage very well, because this is the Ten Commandments. And God spoke all these words, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything, in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live in the land of the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor." When the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain in the smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself and we will listen, but do not let God speak to us or we will die." Moses said to the people, "Do not be afraid. God has come to test you so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning." Come, let us ask the Lord to grant us the wisdom to understand His words to us, and that we may hear His message, understand it, and put it into practice in our lives. Come, let us pray. Most gracious and heavenly Father, Lord, we have heard your word to us, Lord, and we as people are so finite, Lord, we don't always understand what it is that you want to say to us. We've heard your Ten Commandments this morning, and we pray, Lord, that you will just help us to understand them, Help us, Lord, that we can hear your word. And yes, Lord, touch our hearts and our minds with what it is that you want to say to us. Help us to put this into practice so that we can bring honor and glory to your name at all times. O Lord, as I bring your message to these your people, I pray that all the words and the meditations that will flow from my lips will be yours and that they will bring you honor and glory at all times. O Lord, as we come before you now, as all the music fades, as all our masks are taken away, we stand naked before you. Receive us, embrace us, and speak to us. Teach us, Lord, in God's Son's wonderful name, our Lord Jesus Christ.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, you're looking into my heart, yeah. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it, when it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. my heart, into my heart. I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song. Yeah. I'll bring you more than a song. I'll bring you more than a song.
Today I want to speak about something that we don't like hearing, and that is the word rules. Now when we hear the word rules, we shiver, because we know with rules comes discipline, and that is something that we don't like very much. We don't like being told what to do, because we are ourselves and we are autonomous and we are individuals, and we don't like other people telling us. But I want to start off with a little bit something lighter. And I want to ask you that, who of you have cats? Some of you may have one or two cats, and you may not have a cat now, but you may have had a cat previously in your life. But I want you to think of this. Cats have their own will, don't they? They're not like dogs. Dogs become obedient, but cats are something different. They have their own will, and they have their own mind, and they do what they want to. And I want to share with you, and it's just, you know, something to smile at this morning, 10 rules that I believe cats have made for themselves. Now, please remember, these are 10 rules for cats by cats. And the first one is, life is hard, then you take a nap. Have you seen anything as lazy as a cat? If a cat has had a hard time or believes life is hard, what does he do? He goes and he lays next to the window in the sun and he takes a nap. No matter what you say or no matter what anybody else says, the cat wants to sleep, he will sleep. Second one is, curiosity never killed anything except maybe a few hours. Don't you think cats are very curious? And when they see something, they always want to go and poke their nose in there and have a look. That's the idiom that we have in English, curiosity killed the cat. But cats don't believe that. And therefore their rule is, curiosity never killed anything except maybe a few hours. The third one, when in doubt, cop an attitude. Have you ever seen how cats can ignore you? Oh boy, when you talk to cats and you want them to do something, they'll even turn their heads away from you, turn their bodies away from you, and they will just not do anything. They will just, as they would say, park you and ignore. They also believe that ignoring people is the spice of life. And then they will try and ignore you until the next day. Fifth one, climb your way to the top. That is what drapes and curtains are for. You ever had that? I had a cat which had the name of Smokey. And I had another one too that, boy oh boy, they love putting their claws into the curtains and using them as a ladder to get to the top. Number six, never sleep alone when you can sleep with a human being and sleep either next to his head or on top of his face. Have you ever experienced that? And then, of course, when they get there and they lay down, you hear that diesel engine of theirs start. Brr, brr, brr. They don't mind where they sleep. They don't want to sleep alone. And then, as I've said previously, number seven, find your place in the sun, especially if it happens to be on a nice pile of warm, clean laundry. Cats just love something soft, and they love to be in the sun, and they just love to lay down and be lazy. Number 8, when eating out, think nothing of sending back your meal 20 or 30 times. You noticed when you put cats' food down, they'll eat a bit, and then as if something's wrong with the food, they'll just stop eating, they'll turn around, and they'll walk away. Number 9, make your mark in the world, or at least in each corner of the house. Or in the beginning, if there's not a sandbox in the house, and if your cat hasn't been trained, they make their marks. I had a white cat, or in actual fact, the cat belonged to Rita, and the cat didn't get a name, so we just referred to the cat as Vitkat. But now Vitkat was very spiteful. And if Vitkat didn't get her way, she would make her mark, and she would let her tummy go in the middle of the living room on the carpet. And that is how we knew that Vitkat was upset with us. And number 10, always give generously. This is now a cat giving generously. A small mouse or a rat left on the bed or in a shoe tells human beings that they love us. Can you relate to this? I'm sure you can. Now, you know, I told you these rules because cats' lives seem to be in quite a bit of a chaos. They're different to other animals. Yes, we love cats and we love stroking them and we love cuddling with them. But their life seems to be in total chaos. I want to speak today about the rules that were given to us by God. We know them as the Ten Commandments. Theologians refer to them as the Decalogue. But when I speak and refer to the law, I'm speaking about God's law. I need to be very clear that I'm not speaking about the Judaistic law. Although the Judaistic or the rabbinic laws include the Ten Commandments or the Decalogue, I'm not speaking of the other thousands of laws that were man-made by rabbis and priests and added until they numbered over 6,000. I'm talking today, especially only on the 10 commandments that God gave to us. And we need to understand today, and I know a lot of people have the idea of we don't have to adhere to the Old Testament anymore because we've got the New Testament, and that's when Jesus came. Jesus came with a new covenant, and therefore we don't have to listen to the Ten Commandments. We don't have to listen to why or what the Ten Commandments or the Decalogue has to say to us in a modern day context. But I just want us to go back to the history of the Ten Commandments. We must understand and remember why the Ten Commandments came. And we must remember that the Israelites became slaves in Egypt. Remember, a great big time and a whole generation died out in the time from when Joseph was, can I say, second in charge, but he was the main man in Egypt, to when the new Pharaoh took over. And the Israelites lived in this land as slaves because, as I said last time, the Pharaoh didn't know Joseph, and all he saw was these foreigners living in his country. And he saw them as a threat, and he saw them that they might take over his country. And therefore they lived as slaves in Egypt. But as they lived in slaves, it's the only life they knew. And remember, we're talking of a new generation of Israelites, people who did not know God as well as we know him, or the previous generation of Israelites knew him. So they would worship the same gods as what the Egyptians would worship. Now remember, the Egyptians worshipped over 200 gods. They had different gods. They had different gods for different things. Like, for example, they had Horus. Horus was the war god. They had Bez. Bez, who was the fertility god, not only within human beings, but he was also the god for the crops. And he would be known as the fertility god. And so I can continue and mention all the different gods that they had in Egypt. So we must remember, in this time that it transpired, the Israelites didn't know better. And when Moses arrived and said, I'm going to emancipate you and take you out of Egypt, they never knew of this big God, the Israelite God, or as we refer to him, Yahweh. The Israelites now had to learn that God was the only God. They now had to believe in a monotheistic. In other words, there's only one God, and he is the Almighty God. And they had to now do away from their previous worship of all these other gods. So in their wanderings in the desert, in the wilderness, like I said last week, where there was literally nothing, God took this opportunity to teach them the way they had to live, the way God wanted them to live. And that is why God then brought down, or shall I say, took Moses up the mountain to give him the Ten Commandments. Now, a lot of us don't like rules because we believe they're a set of rules, and these rules are going to take away our freedom. And then they have to bring discipline, and I have to follow what other people say, and I can't do and have my freedom to live my life. And that is a total misconception of what the Ten Commandments are about. Other people have the misperception that if we follow these Ten Commandments, God will love us and God will save us, and then he will care for us. So in other words, it's only if we are obedient will God love us. But I want to say to you that God said to the Israelites, he said, I hear your cry as slaves in Egypt. And then he says, I will deliver you because I love you. He didn't say, I'm going to deliver you for any other reason to make you slaves in some other place. He said, I will deliver you because I love you. But then God adds, when you are safe and when you are free, I will give you a new life. And is that not what happened? Remember, God didn't give them the Ten Commandments as an instruction of how to get out of Egypt. No. He first brought them out of Egypt because he had compassion on them. He loves them. And he set them free. And it was only when they were in the wilderness or the desert that God gave them the Ten Commandments in how to live a new life. Salvation from God is not a reward for obedience. And a lot of people get confused by this. They reckon that if I adhere to the Ten Commandments, I will get salvation from God. No. God gives you that salvation before he even gave the Ten Commandments to the Israelites. So God just gives you the Ten Commandments as a way in which you are to live your life after you have received the salvation. And we need to understand that. It's not vice versa. We obey the Ten Commandments because we love God and not because we are scared of him. A lot of people, and remember, I know this is an old-time theology, and a lot of the older ministers used to preach fire and brimstone and forced people into following and being obedient to God because the people were scared of God. And I want to say to you that that is not how God works. But we do the obedience thing of the Ten Commandments because of our great love for God. Remember, I said that we serve God because we love Him, not because we're trying to earn a place in heaven. Loving God, and listen to this very carefully, loving God includes accepting the Ten Commandments as a standard of values, behavior, ethics, and morals. In other words, have you ever had a look on ethics and morals that we have today? No, because we have stopped reading our Bible. Many people have stopped following God. So our ethics and our morals and our values just have seemed to have disappeared. It's because we have got rid of the Bible in our lives and living a life the way we think it is. It's almost as if we are like the cats, making our own rules as we go along. A classic example of this is, and I shared this story with you some time ago, and I want to share it with you again because I believe it is very relevant to our message today. But a friend of mine in Kimberley went through a divorce, and his wife had an affair with another man, and she decided that it was time to leave my friend and go with this other man because he had more money and he offered her riches and affluence. But there was adultery committed. Now, will you remember the one commandment I read this morning? Is God said, thou shalt not commit adultery. Now, because we don't in our community follow the biblical ethics and morals and behaviors, we went to a lawyer and we said, but what about this guy that broke this marriage? Because adultery was committed, yeah. The lawyer said to me that societal norms dictate, and they dictate that it's okay to have an affair, it's okay to have another man, and it's okay to divorce your husband to take somebody else. Now that is totally contradictory to what the scriptures say to us. It's totally contradictory to the commandments that God gave to us. So you see, folks, we've become like the cats. We do as we please. We ignore God. We ignore one another. And we just make up our own rules as we go along. I don't know how many of you watch the series on the Universal Channel of NCIS with Gibbs and all the people that work with him, Bishop and all those people. But he would always just make up a rule and he'll say, rule 39, never do this or never do that. It's just like the cats. And that is why we find our world in such a tiz today. We find that our world is broken. We find that nobody cares about nobody and nobody loves nobody. It's because we have started making our own rules. I want to make a statement today. And I'm going to put it up on the screen so that you can see it. And I will read it to you. And I want this to stake and to sink in to our minds. I want to make a statement on why it is important to still follow the Ten Commandments in a modern day context. The Ten Commandments are rules for free people to stay free. Remember, they were given to the Israelites when they were free, and God gave them so that they could stay free. You see, folks, we worship Jesus Christ. Jesus died and set us free from the bondage of sin. So the Ten Commandments have been given to us as free people, but the Ten Commandments are still relevant to us to keep us free, to make sure that we do not fall under the bondage of sin again, and that our freedom is taken away from us. Folks, I want us to go and sit and think a little bit about the Ten Commandments. And I've said this before and I've asked you. And remember when Jesus was asked, Lord, which is the most important commandment? Jesus said, it's to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, and your soul. And secondly, it's to love one another. Now, if we take the Ten Commandments and we could sum them up in one word, that word would be love. You can go. Thou shalt not kill. Why? Why shalt I not kill? It's because I love the one that I want to kill. I shall not serve any other gods. It's because I love my God with all my heart, my mind, and my soul. I shalt not covet my neighbor's things. Why? It's because I love my neighbor, and therefore I will not become jealous and want his things. You see, folks, we can go through all 10 of them, and we can summarize them, and it all comes down to love. So, folks, if the Ten Commandments is about love, is that not exactly what Jesus commanded us to do? Did he not tell us those are the two most important commandments? In conclusion this morning, I just want to say to you that the Ten Commandments are still relevant today as what they were in the times of the biblical Old Testament. The Ten Commandments are there to show us the way to live our lives so that our lives may exhibit the way to love our neighbors. And lastly, the way to love our God with all our hearts and our minds and our souls. So I challenge you this week to go out, to take your Bible, go and read the Ten Commandments again. Find the love in each of the Ten Commandments. Put them into practice so that we can live our lives with the morals, the values, the ethics that God has given to us, so we can restore some discipline, some order, and some sense into our society. It is a way to love. It is a way to bring us back to God. Amen. Come, let us thank the Lord for speaking to us today, and for opening his word so that we could see and so that we can just hear. Come, let us pray. Gracious Lord, we thank you, Lord, for giving us the Ten Commandments, Lord. We thank you for your motivation in giving them to us so that we could have guidance in a life where we seem to be so lost. Lord, help us to realize the importance of the Ten Commandments so that we can live our lives the way you want us to live them, with all your ethics, with all your values, with all your morals, Lord, so that we can bring honor and glory to your name. Gracious Lord, help us to see that this is not a set of rules that bog us down, but that they have been given to a free people to stay free. Help us to realize that that is what you've intended so that we can have a freedom, Lord. Lord, we thank you for caring so much. Thank you, Lord, that you gave us these commandments because you love us and that you were worried about us and that you wanted to make sure that we stayed free and stayed safe from the evil one. Lord, help us in these coming weeks to remember the Ten Commandments and to put them into practice in our lives so that we may glorify you, Lord. Oh Lord, we thank you and we praise you that you are our God. We thank you and we praise you that you love us and that you give us love and that you give us the ability to love. We thank you, Lord, and we praise you that you are with us all the time and that you never leave us, you never forsake us, just as you have promised. O Lord, we pray your blessing and your presence with us in this new coming week. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to guide us and to be with us and that you will help us to love and that we will truly be your pioneers for your wonderful love in this world. So, Lord, we pray this, we praise you and we worship you and we thank you. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us conclude our service today by praising the Lord and proclaiming that we are no longer slaves to fear.
You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears have come. I'm no child.
Folks, that brings our service to an end today. Receive now the blessing. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of His Holy Spirit be with us here now today and forevermore. Amen. And may God bless each and every one of you with His richest blessing until we meet again. Amen. Folks, it's been an honor and a privilege once again to be with you. I thank you for allowing me into your homes and your personal spaces. It's been an honor in bringing and sharing the Word of God with you. Rest assured, as from next week when the church reopens, our online services will continue and I will still be coming into your homes. So until we meet again, stay safe, stay healthy, and never forget that God is always there for you. He's just a prayer away. Goodbye now.
May the good Lord bless and keep you, whether near or far away. May you find that long-awaited golden day today. May your troubles all be small ones, and your fortune 10 times 10. May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet again. May you walk with sunlight shining and a bluebird in every tree. May there be a silver lining back of every cloud you see. Fill your dreams with sweet tomorrows. Never mind might have been. May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet again.
May you walk with sunlight shining
and a bluebird in every tree.
May there be a silver
of every cloud you see. Fill your dreams with sweet tomorrows. Never mind what might have been. May the good Lord bless and keep you till we meet again. May the good Lord bless and keep you.